it's nice to see that there are some people who are at least interested in the analog side of games. So welcome. I was sure I was going to give this only to the alt party people, but it's nice to see a few more of you here. Anyway, my name is Petri Purho, and I'm probably the best known for making crayon physics. And I've also made a bunch of other smaller prototype games that I've published. But this talk, I decided to make some board games this year, and to make a board game every year, every month, I mean. In this talk, I'm going to describe the 7 games I've made so far, and I'm going to give very brief descriptions of the game. I'm not going to give the full rules of every game, because that would take way too long and be kind of boring. But I'm also going to try to tell you some lessons learned, and hopefully you guys get something out of this. I have to say, though, that I'm not an expert at board game design, or even like a huge board gamer myself, but I kind of decided, because I'm interested in game design, I decided to start doing this, and hopefully you'll get something out of this. First of all, I have to give some credits and inspiration. Stone Librandi, who's a game designer who worked at Maxis and Blizzard earlier, he inspired me by giving this talk, 15 games in 15 years. And his idea was that he made one game every year for his kids. And I think this is still an ongoing project. And you can see this talk online freely if you Google for it. And I highly recommend you watch it. It's a good talk. The Experiment and Gameplay Project guys deserve a mention, because essentially they inspired me to start making games and making games on a regular schedule. But most importantly, I have to thank Erik Sveding for this, because he's a game designer most probably best known for making Blueberry Garden, but he's also currently working on this Else Heartbreak game, which is like this adventure hacking game, and it's really cool. But he's helped me with this project directly by we've designed half of these games with Erik together, and he inspired me indirectly by making this game called Slice and Dice. And this is a 2-player card and die game. And I played this originally like 4 years ago now. And I still consider it to be one of the best card board games that I've played. It's a really good game. Unfortunately, it's unpublished. So it's really hard to get a chance to play it. But if you do, I highly recommend it. So the reason it really inspired me was this was the first time I've played a board game that made by a friend of mine that was on the quality level on par with like published games, or even better in my opinion. So let's get on with these games that I've made. So the first game in January was called No More Meat, and it was made by me, Erik, and Anna Sajaskowski. And this game was originally made I've kind of cheated here, because this game was originally made in 2012 at No More Sweden. Here's me and Erik in this picture. But what I did in January is I used a service called the Game Crafter, which is an internet service. And what I did is I got a printed copy of this game, which I have here with me. It's actually got a box, and you can kind of see the components there. So that's what I did in January. So I kind of pimped it up. So here's some people playing the older version of it. So to describe the game, I'm just going to read from the back of the box. No More Meat. Have you ever wanted to feel morally superior over your friends without the inconvenience of changing your lifestyle? Now you can, in a new and exciting card game about gaining karma through dietary restrictions and trying to get other players to eat their forbidden food and also avoiding death from starvation. So in this game, No More Meat, you kind of promise not to eat certain things. So here, for example, I've promised not to eat broccoli and fish. And then, because I have 2 restrictions, I gain 2 karma points each turn. And whoever gets to 10 karma points wins the game. But also in my turn, here's my hand of cards, I have to put a food item into one of these 3 pans on the table. And once one of these pans has enough foods on them, it is served to all the players. And then if you end up eating something you've promised not to eat, like if this fish would end up on me, I'd lose all my karma points. So that's the basics of the game. And all these three pans here, they function differently. So this shuffle one, once it's full, all the cards are flipped face down and shuffled and dealt to all the players. In the select one, everyone selects one and passes the cards around to the next person until they're gone. And in the backwards one, they're dealt backwards. And this kind of dealing mechanic really worked really well for the game. It's a really kind of interesting mechanic that I haven't seen used elsewhere. So the way the game got done is that No More Sweden, you pull up these words from a hat, and then you're supposed to make a game out of them. And the word we got was vegetarianism. And Eric's a vegetarian, and I'm not, so we decided to make this game where you kind of fight about who's got the best diet. And the way we made the game is No More Sweden is essentially a jam that lasts for a weekend. So what we did is we decided, first of all, to make a board game, because when you go to a game jam, you end up seeing lots of friends that you don't usually see, but then you end up hunching over your computer and programming a game. So we decided, let's make a board game, so at least we have some social interaction. And that's what we kind of decided to do. And we spent the first day working on the game, and we got it to function pretty well. This is kind of what it looked like. We made the stuff out of post-it notes, and we wrote onto playing cards. And we made the game, and the game was fun to play, and we thought we would be done with it. Here's a pro tip. If any of you want to make a board game or make a card game, I highly recommend that you use Sharpies. This is a specific brand of markers, and the reason you want to use this, you can get Sharpies from Kynä and Paperi, Hämeentie, in case you're interested where to get them in Finland. Anyway, the reason you want to use Sharpies is if you use other markers, they very easily smudge when you write onto playing cards, or they'll kind of crack and get lost. Sharpies, they dry up very fast and they stick. So anyway, that's what we did. We used Sharpies and we wrote onto playing cards, and we had our game. The problem was we ended up playtesting it with Anna, and she really liked the game, and she insisted that we should make proper art for it. And she insisted that she'll make the art for it. So instead of spending the rest of the weekend drinking beer and slacking off, we had to kind of like draw up all these things, design them, then cut the papers and cut the cardboard and do the stuff. So here's a photo of us working. Here's another pro tip. If you want to make a bit better looking prototype, the thing to do is get Magic Gathering card sleeves and print out your cards, then cut them out of the paper and stick them into the card sleeves with a playing card. You can get card sleeves from Fantasia Pelit. And what you end up is usually a game that looks kind of way better than the original. So here's what our original game looked like, and we thought we would be done with this. This was perfect to us because we were two game designers, so we didn't really care about the graphics. This is what we ended up with after the game jam. And this is the final printed one. So some lessons learned from this first board game. This is a rather obvious one. It's that art matters. Coming from digital games, I've learned that if your game looks nice, it's a lot easier to get players engaged with it. But the interesting part is art really matters for board games because there's a time investment when you play a board game. You really need to learn the rules and convince other players to play it with you. So it's a lot more important for board games. Essentially what happened in No More Sweden is we tried to get people to play this game on the left with us. We tried to drag people in and come on, play this game, and no one really wanted to play it. After we actually got the art done, everyone was kind of flocking our game and wanted to play it, and we were like, stay away, we don't have enough. Another thing that really worked for us is working with another game designer here. Here's Eric and Martin. two of the designers I've most collaborated with. When you work on a computer game and you kind of want to test it, it's really easy to test it yourself, just like compile the game and play around with it. When you're making a board game, the iteration loop potentially is much faster if you can have someone to play test it as you're kind of designing it. And having another designer there to bounce off ideas really made the game, like the designing experience was mostly just like playing the game and figuring out, like, this part isn't really working, we should fix it and maybe figure out something else for this part. And the one that was kind of interestingly non-intuitive for me is I really enjoyed having a physical box for the game. I don't know why. I thought I was immune to this kind of marketing thing of having a box for something, but apparently I'm not. Maybe it's because all the games I've done so far are digital, so I've never actually been able to hold them in my hand. So this ability to actually get a physical copy has changed my my viewpoints about this game greatly. Also, this game is much easier now to get playtesters on because it actually has a box. Everyone's convinced that this is a real game. And it's just a game box, but apparently it changes so much. The last bit of no more meat that kind of worked for us is this notion of post-action lock versus pre-action lock. And this is a thing I learned from a Soren Johnson lecture. Because I've always kind of wondered, when I play board games, I'm kind of against random elements in a game. Like, if I have to roll a die, it feels like the game is kind of like random and I don't really care for it. But if I play something like Magic the Gathering, I don't, like, the game is random, but it doesn't bother me as much. And I've never really quite understood why is that. But it was explained to me by Soren. So the idea is post-action lock is the standard randomization you usually have in a game, which is you decide to make some kind of an action, and then you roll the dice to see if that action succeeds. So an example of this is in Risk, you decide to attack a country, you move all your units there, then you roll your dice and see if you've managed to do it. And that doesn't really feel fair. It feels random because the dice are kind of making the decision. And pre-action luck, on the other hand, is where the random elements are before you make the decision. So, like, for example, getting the cards from Magic the Gathering doesn't feel as random as the post-action luck. There's also die games where that use pre-action luck. So, for example, a game where you use the dice as a worker, so you'd roll all the dice first and then you decide where to use them, is an example of a pre-action luck with the dice. And this kind of worked with No More Meat, because No More Meat is kind of luck-based game to a degree, but it doesn't feel as random as a lot of die games. So for February, I made this game called Cold War Hot Nukes, which I have here. And here's a picture of the components in here. And here's a photo of the prototype version of the game kind of looked like. Here's kind of the table setup. So this game was kind of inspired by Android Netrunner. John von Neumann's game theory and the actual Cold War. The way the game is played, this is one of the player's hands. And they can have these different types of cards. So here, these are nukes that can be used to destroy the opponent. These are peace cards that can be used to advance the peace. These are spy cards that you can kind of see what the opponent is doing. And these help you with production, and these give you victory points. So on your turn, you can put any number of these face down in front of you. And then on your turn, you get two workers, and you can put these workers however you want on the cards you have face down in front of you. And when you feel like it, you can, and when they have enough workers, you can flip them over and do the effect on them. So for example, here, this adds, once this is complete, here's the number it requires, one, you can add three workers to any single project. So here they're added to the other one. It's the dark ritual of this game. So then that gets discarded. And then this can be flipped over, and this essentially says here that it requires one worker there for it to be flipped over, and three is kind of the maximum it can have. So you get three victory points for it, and then that gets discarded. And you keep your victory points also hidden. So that's essentially kind of how the game is played. The game can either end in world peace if the world peace counter reaches 10 or more, which you can advance yourself, or you can end the game in a nuclear standoff. And if it ends in a nuclear standoff, both of the players launch their missiles until they've ran out of nuclear missiles. And you can use a nuclear missile to destroy either an opponent's card or an opponent's victory point. And then in either case, in the world peace or the nuclear standoff, we just like reveal how many victory points each player has, and whoever has more wins the game. And the game kind of works in this kind of interesting fashion, where you're kind of not sure what your opponent is doing, if he's bluffing with the cards and building a nuclear arsenal, or if he's going for world peace, or if you're kind of leading in victory points or not. And I like this game. What I did for this, here's kind of a pro tip, is you can often use public domain art instead of doing everything yourself. I found these awesome 50s surviving the atom bomb pamphlets from archive.org that are in public domain, and I took the artwork from there. So lessons learned. Production takes time. Like this game looks kind of nice, but it took a lot of time to do it. And the problem with, once you set up a quality bar for making a board game, you kind of have to make all your components in that quality level, and that really can easily end up sucking a lot of time. This is kind of obvious, but the fewer players you have, the easier the game is to test. I was originally going to make a game that required 4 players to play it, but because I had to do this every month, I couldn't really organize a playtesting session to get 4 people to come together. So I ended up making a 2-player game. So I could just use my girlfriend as a tester. And I don't really recommend using Photoshop to do card games, because it's a hassle. I don't know if there's any tool that's better for making the stuff, but I'm considering programming my own, because I got really burned out on Photoshop in this project. The interesting game design bit about this game is it uses quite a lot of hidden information. And as I said earlier, I have this kind of hate for randomness in games. But for some reason, I'm okay with hidden information. And from the game design perspective, hidden information actually acts very much like randomness in a game. So I kind of got the benefits of the randomness just by using hidden information, which I consider a success. So for March, we made a game called No More Space. I teamed up with Eric Sverring again. And I made this game. Also ordered from GameCrafter. Just gonna stick it here. It's gonna fall off, so maybe it's better off here. So in this game, the idea is that it's a 2-4 player game, and the idea is you're mining asteroids and mining minerals out of asteroids, and whoever gets the most minerals at the end of the game is the winner. And the game ends when this stack of action tiles is all used. And here's essentially the setup for 2 players. Here's the blue player's ships, and here's the red player's ships, and here's the action tiles, so everyone gets 3 action tiles. Here's the minerals that everyone's after, and here's like a black hole and a bomb, and this is a dead star. So the way the game is played, and on your turn, you can do one of 3 actions. You can either place one of these ships you have somewhere on the board, you can either use one of the action tiles you have, or you can mine for minerals. And the way you mine for minerals is you mine with all the ships you have out there. So here is like in a stop motion action how the game is played. So the red player puts this ship down here to mine. It's planning of mining these. Then the blue player puts her ship here. And then the red player uses a teleport and teleports the blue ship out of there. And then the blue player put a magnet here, pulled the red ship over there, and then the other one used, the red player used, exploded this bomb and killed this ship, and then the blue player put their ship here because the board wraps around, so they're trying to mine these here, and the red player warped his ship forward into here, and oh yeah, the blue player used the teleport and moved it over here. And the red player put a magnet here and pulled it back. And apparently the blue player actually mined here, so they got three minerals. And so that's essentially how the game goes on and on. It's like you're essentially as much you're trying to get into good positions as much as you're trying to screw up the opponent by trying to get them out of there. And it's a bit like the Amazing Labyrinth, but with tiles. It's kind of this fun and chaotic game. So the game ends when these action tiles are gone. Whoever has the most minerals wins. So the way the game was made is we spent a weekend in Gothenburg, and we made the game. We made an early prototype of the game, essentially just by using blank playing cards. And if you're interested, you can buy blank playing cards from Aprilli. It's in Kampina. It used to be in Kaisaniemi. It's like this carnival store. They sell blank playing cards. So we took blank playing cards and we cut them into squares and then we drew on them with Sharpies. And we got the game to a pretty playable state after about a day and a half. And it was a pretty fun game. Then what we did is Eric drew these tiles and watercolored them in. And then we printed them on to sticker paper, which you can buy at Clas Ohlson if you're interested in this kind of stuff. So we printed it out on sticker paper, and then we cut the tiles out of there. And then we bought a shitty children's memory game to get some tiles. And essentially, we glued the stickers onto the tiles, and we had our nice custom-made tile sets. Here's some pictures of what the kind of finished prototype looked like. And here's the final Game Crafter one. So another pro tip if you're kind of making these kind of very graphically heavy board games and trying to do it with other people is like use BitTorrent Sync instead of Dropbox because Dropbox only has that 2 GB limit and it's completely useless. Also, it doesn't upload your files to the NSA if you use BitTorrent Sync. So some lessons learned. This is pretty obvious, but we made the game was pretty short, so that allowed us to welcome. I can start from the beginning if you want. This allowed us to test the game. We had only about a weekend to do so. If we had made like a 4-hour epic game, it would have maybe gotten a 1 or 2 playtests. But having this like 15 to 30 minute game, we essentially just playtested it until it was, we had nothing to change in that game. Also, what happened with this game is we kind of let the game run its course. We originally had this other mechanic in mind that we really wanted to do from Slice and Dice, where you kind of, this kind of splitting mechanic. And that's what we originally started making the game with. But then we got the actual components and we started playing it and we were like, this original idea is not really good, but this kind of other part of it is really interesting. So we just kind of decided to go with that and run with it. I highly recommend, don't let your ideas hold you back if the game seems to go. So for April, I made this game called Transformers. And it's a game about worms on a tile set. I made it for Ludum Dare 29, and the theme was underground. I didn't quite make it during the jam time, so it's not really a Ludum Dare game, but it's, my original idea was to make it during the jam time. So the way the game is played is each player controls this worm here, and they can move it around, and once they get onto one of these cubes, they can use one of the abilities on the worm. So for example, if this worm eats this yellow cube, it can use the yellow cube to buy one of these new parts to it. And then one of these parts here allows it to get these level 2 parts, and one of them allows you to get these level 3 parts. And what you're after is these diamonds here. So those are essentially the victory points in the game. And you can convert different cubes into diamonds. So here's a stop motion version of the game. So both of these players kind of like are extending their worms and moving around. And here's the interesting part. Like this player here purchases another head to its worm, and then it splits off the worm. So it's now actually this player is now actually controlling two worms. And you can also eat other worms if they have enough attack versus how much defense the other worm has. So this worm here is kind of trying to munch on it, but apparently it gets eaten by this other one here. And the game ends when there's this bag where you pick up these cubes, and once the bag is empty of the cubes, whoever has the most victory points wins the game. So some lessons learned from Transwormers. Busy work is something you kind of want to avoid. What busy work in board games is essentially the stuff you need to do in order to kind of play the game, but that's not really playing the game. So for example, when you have to set up the board in Axis and Allies, you're not really playing the game, but it's a lot of work to do that. So it's like shuffling and dealing cards. That's busy work where you're not like really making any kind of a decision, but you're still kind of doing something. And although this game kind of looks way more playable as a stop motion animation, playing the actual game is like you have to move all the tiles and move all the cubes, and it's a lot of this kind of uninteresting work to play it. And it's like this busy work almost kills the game. And it's kind of interesting because in computer games, on the other hand, people don't seem to mind busy work as much. Like there are genres that are built on busy work, like free to play, where you don't actually essentially do anything except busy work. But on board games, apparently, that's no good. But yeah, so for the month of May, I made this game called Elemental War, is what I call it. This is kind of an interesting case. The game is a bit like an area control game, where you start out in places and then you can summon these creatures that are a bit like Magic the Gathering creatures. They've got different movements and they have different elements that can be used to attack the other players and so forth. And the kind of idea that I had for it was to use these non-transitive dice. And the way non-transitive dice work is essentially we have a die here called the A, and it's got 0 on 2 of its side and 4 on 4 of its side. So that die has about 2/3 of a chance of beating this die B that's only got 3s on it. This die, on the other hand, has 2/3 of a chance beating this die C, and this die C has 2/3 of a chance of beating die D. The interesting part is the die D has 2/3 of a chance of beating the die A. So it's essentially like this loop. So it's very much like rock, paper, scissors, but with dies. And I thought this was really kind of cool mathematical idea. Here's all the sides of the die, if anyone is interested in the math part of it. Unfortunately, for this game, what I learned from it is that this kind of a gimmicky die thing didn't really work very well for it. 2/3 of a chance is not big enough of a chance in a game like this to actually matter. So it ended up being very random, even though it had this kind of a rock, paper, scissors effect to it. Because you still have every third time you might lose, even though you're essentially supposed to be winning. It didn't balance out during the game enough, so it felt random nonetheless. And it could have also been just implemented with normal dice and just like adding modifiers to it. The other part about it that I learned is I need to finish the game, finish my slides as well. There's two parts to this. One thing that happened with Elemental War is this was the first game I didn't kind of make a nice version out of it. So what ended up happening is I didn't play test it as much as the earlier games. And the reason for it was like I didn't really want to show it to anyone because it was kind of in this unfinished state. So the game hasn't really been play tested as much as the other ones. Hence, the game is not as nice and playable as the other ones. And the other part about it is it also, when I didn't finish it, it also kind of killed my momentum and motivation to make the other games. So up to this point, I've kind of had this getting these nice boxes and games done have kind of motivated me to make these games. And now that I kind of skipped on this part, it kind of killed my motivation. So for the month of June, what I did is I was working on this political game, but it wasn't really going anywhere, and I felt kind of unmotivated. So I recycled an old game that I've made a long time ago, and that game's called Drink and Strip. And this game is played with a regular deck of cards and a bottle of Jallu. And the way the game is played is you deal 5 cards to each player, and on their turn, each player puts 1 card from their hand. So for example, here, this player puts the 8 of hearts in front of this player. And you go around like this, putting cards in front of other players until everyone gets 5 cards in front of them. So now, whoever has the best poker hand, which in this case is this player here on the left, they've got 3 eights. Both of these have 2 pairs. And this player only has 1 pair, which is kind of hidden there. So anyway, whoever gets the best poker hand in this reverse poker has to take a drink. And whoever gets the worst poker hand, in this case, is this player, has to remove an article of clothing. And this game is probably one of the worst games I've ever made in a lot of sense. But it's also kind of fun. Some lessons learned. If you want to make a game kind of quickly, making a game with a regular deck of cards is really good, because essentially you cut down all the production work you have to do. So essentially it's pure game design in that sense. You don't have to worry about making nice cards and stuff. You just like do it with a normal deck of cards. Also, the other part is adding drinking to any game makes that game better. But playtesting a game that has drinking in it is very dangerous, because if the game has a bug in it, one person might end up in the hospital, and that's no good. And what essentially Drink and Strip is it's a game of politics in the board game sense. Like, if you've ever played Munchkin very easily turns into this game of everyone ganging up on the player who's going to win and trying to get them down, and then in reverse, moving to the next player who might get there. And then it becomes like this game of like, okay, I'll give you a beer if you help me in this mission, where you kind of like try to bribe other players. And it's this kind of a big mess of not actually playing the game, but this kind of political thing. And Drink and Strip is very much that, except it's got this punishment and reward thing kind of built into it. And it's rather interesting game, but I don't really want to play it anymore. So for the month of July, and this is the last game, I was again at No More Sweden this year, and me and Eric made this game called No More Money. So in case you haven't figured out the pattern here. So in this game, all the players are essentially bankers, and what they're trying to do is get as many victory points from the stock market as possible. So the way the game is played, these green beads here, these are victory points, and this is the money. So at the beginning of the game, you openly auction who's going to be the banker for that round. So in this case, this is the player who's the banker. And the banker has the ability to give out loans to other players. So here, they negotiate a loan with this player for 50 bucks. But this player only has to pay back 5 for 5 turns. And these 2 victory points are security here. So if this player doesn't pay back, this player gets the victory points. And you might be wondering, why does he only have to pay back 5 for 5 turns for 50? Well, the reason is that the banker only has to put out 10% of the money he's going to loan. So in this case, the banker is giving out a 5 that you can see going out here. And then the printing press is going to give out 50 to this player. So essentially, there is an in-game inflation in happening in here. And then everyone, the second part of the game is everyone kind of takes a certain amount of money in their hand, like secret amount. They have like this cover, so you don't actually know how much money each player has. And they bring it forth, and they reveal. And whoever paid the most gets to buy one of these stocks here first. So these are D6 and D12. He buys the D6. And whoever paid the second most, which is this player in this case, would get the D12. And whoever paid the third most doesn't get anything. And then at the beginning of the next round, we roll dice. And the dice are corresponding to these cards. So this is a D12 for the D12 and D6 for the D6. And if a 1 comes up, that market crashes. So here you can see the D12 is going to crash. So the player who had the D12 loses it. If a 1 doesn't come up, more victory points are added to that market. And when the game ends, and it ends when the 5th crash happens, whoever has the most victory points wins the game. Most victory points secured. Yeah, because at the end of your turn, you can kind of take all the victory points out of a market and discard that market card. So you can't kind of like keep them there safely. So essentially, that's the game. So a pro tip, just cannibalize other board games. For this game, we bought Modern Art, which was like 20 euros, and took all the money tokens out of it. Essentially, much cheaper than making them your own, and much faster. Some lessons learned from it. So if your game has some kind of an economy in it, one of the things you can do, and things we did here, is like we took ideas from the real world and implemented them in the board game. And it really kind of functioned way better than we thought. The loan negotiations in the game very much remind you of the loan negotiations you have to do within a bank. And what we also did with this game is, when we started out making the game, we had this idea of like using loans, and then we figured out how to make this loan mechanic, and it was really fun. But the problem with it was the inflation kind of killed the game. So the first player who got to be the banker, he would give out 10 to someone else. Then that player would become the banker. They would give out 100 to someone else. And that player would become the banker, and they would give 1,000 to someone else. And it just like got out of hand. But we figured out how to combine it with the auction mechanic, and that kind of put the pieces nicely together. So that's about my presentation. Here's a picture of all the games I've made so far. Hopefully there will be more. If you have any questions, I'd be happy to answer them. Yes, we have at least one. Hello. I don't think it's working.
Yeah. How much does it cost to print out one of those games, and are there any limits you have to order 20 or anything
like
that? Oh
yeah, excellent question. I was actually supposed to gonna answer that earlier, but I totally forgot doing it. So this game, No More Meat, which is essentially has rule booklet couple of cards and stuff. This game, the cost of it was, a single copy cost was $18.40. The shipping of this to Finland was $40. So that ended up being like $60 worth of it, but I mean, it's still relatively cheap to get a single copy of it. And there's no limitations to it. This thing, I think, was about the same-ish. This essentially has cards and some other components in it. No More Space was a bit more expensive because I think the board and I think the tiles were kind of a bit more expensive, but I think this was maybe around $30 or $40. So essentially, it's not... I feel like the quality of the components is okay for print and play. It's not the best possible thing. For example, the cards, these are not card stock, like proper card stock. So you can actually, if you look at them against light, you can kind of see through them a bit, which is not what you want for proper playing cards. But it's not a problem when playing the game. But yeah, it's around that much. The shipping is unfortunately the biggest expense. And if it would be a bit cheaper, I'd maybe consider selling them. But at the moment, I feel like it's a bit too much for the games of this quality.
You mentioned the idea that for instance, in free-to-play, you have these chores that you have to do, and they kind of seem fun. And in board games, they don't. I don't know. Like previously, I've heard the exact opposite from other people saying that, like for instance, in board games, it's much more kind of interesting to, for instance, handle Monopoly money. But if you had to do the same in a video game, if you had to actually use money in that game and kind of manually transact different things and yeah, calculate things in your head, that wouldn't be much of a process. So just like...
That's an interesting point. I think the reason for that essentially is like having physical things, it's more interesting to do things with it. But what I meant also with the busy work is like, essentially, if you're playing an RPG game, walking from the town into the shop, the walking bit is essentially busy work, if you consider it in that regard. You're not really making any kind of a decision. Maybe there's a bit of exploration and stuff, but essentially that's not kind of, you're not doing. And I feel like video games allow much more of that, because those kind of interactions can be made way more fun. If you somehow had to kind of move around in a board game, I don't know, maybe that could be made fun because you're moving something physically. But yeah, that's an interesting point. But on the other hand, I'd say like the handling of the money may be fun in Monopoly, but it's not fun as a game. Like you can't build a game around just handling money of Monopoly. You have to actually have some kind of a mechanic. But there's a lot of video games that kind of build a game around just that kind of empty interaction almost. Like where you don't actually, you're just kind of moving things around and not really doing anything. It's not necessarily a very good video game, but I see that happening much more. Does anyone else have any?
Hi, I was wondering how do you distribute these games? I mean, in trial users, for example. In digital games, you can, of course, upload trial version and people can download from anywhere. But how do you handle these kind of issues with board games?
Yeah, that's a good question. Essentially, I don't. These games are, I've made them for myself. There's a single copy of each of them. And I play it with my friends. And I actually haven't considered any kind of commercial side to it. I don't know. I enjoy making games, and hence I make them. There's potentially probably the way to do it would be either through print and play, which is just like giving them out as a downloadable thing, and people can print and play them, or using some kind of like the game crafter actually allows you to sell games directly as a print and play thing. But I feel that the price for the game crafter stuff is a bit too expensive. I don't want to ask for $20 for this game, essentially. That's my problem. I don't feel that's fair to the customer. Can you use the microphone so they can catch it on the live stream, on the recording? Thank you.
Yeah, I'm just thinking maybe you could actually distribute the downloadable thing as a free thing, and then have those like more elaborate prints handed out with money. So it would be essentially a free-to-play board game.
Yeah, that's a good idea. Maybe I'll do something. So far, actually, I've been thinking of putting them out as a downloadable thing and print and play, and maybe making a YouTube video explaining the rules of each of the game and putting the rules out. But so far, this is essentially the second place where I'm even showing these games publicly so far. Maybe I'll do it after I've gotten through the year and seen what I've come up with. And also, there's a possibility of if one of these games turns out to be really good and there's a publisher who is interested in it, that might end up getting into the stores that way. Is there any more questions? If anyone is interested, there's also a possibility of playtesting these games here. I'm probably going to go to the cafe out there. So if anyone's interested in playing any of these, they will be available there. You can just like ask me. Or if you have any questions you want to ask me specifically about things, or if you want to check the quality of the components, you can ask me around. Thank you very much.